Okay, the next item of business is a member's business debate on motion 14053 in the name of Sharon Dowie on addressing retail crime and antisocial behaviour. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put, but I encourage members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons. And I call on Sharon Dowie. Around 7 minutes, Ms. Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to have the chance to raise this pressing issue before Parliament. Retail crime and antisocial behaviour is a growing problem that must be tackled urgently. It's having a hugely detrimental impact not only on workers, but businesses and communities across the whole of Scotland. This is an issue that I am passionate about. Before I became an MSP, I worked in retail for over 30 years. I'm well aware of the impact it has on people's physical and mental health and the damage that it causes to businesses and our economy. Abuse and violence could often be part of the job then, but it was much less common than it is now. Retailers paint a stark picture of the magnitude of the issues they face and the difficulties of trying to tackle this problem without more support from the police or government. This morning, I was pleased to meet with more than a dozen retailers. They told me about the scale of challenges they are facing and the level of antisocial behaviour that shop workers are having to put up with, from throwing food, littering and verbal abuse, to assault, knife threats and worse. A recent report by the Scottish Grocers Federation also highlighted just how bad the situation has become. It revealed incidents where staff had to confront a man wielding a dirty needle, another threw a bike and threatened to stab staff, another hurled a glass bottle, another pulled a knife in staff when he was asked to return bottles of vodka, another tried to bite a worker, and one couple tried to run over a security team in the car park when they were challenged. All horrifying stories. Nobody should have to face this kind of danger when they go to work. That same report included a survey of retailers which demonstrated shoplifting has become a daily occurrence and violence against staff happens every single week. The recent recorded crime in Scotland statistics revealed just how much this problem has been allowed to escalate. When I put my motion in, the increase in shoplifting was 21%. The most recent figures showed a 34% rise. In the area I represent, there was a 40% rise in East Ayrshire and a 22% rise in South Ayrshire. And worryingly, as I heard this morning, that's only incidents that have been reported. Many shops have given up on reporting incidents to overstretched and under-resourced police, so these criminal acts are allowed to happen without justice being delivered. The report highlights that 76% of SGF's members are unlikely or very unlikely to report shoplifting incidents to the police. Behind all of these statistics are real people just trying to go about their work or run their businesses. They just want to earn a living. But they're being denied that opportunity, and the impact spreads across the community they serve and all the people who rely on small shops. David Lonsdale, director of the Scottish Retail Consortium, said of the recent recorded crime figures, "Shoplifting isn't a victimless crime. Shoplifting is the main factor behind abuse and threats towards shop workers, and we know from member feedback that thieves are becoming bolder and more aggressive. The financial costs too are enormous and are ultimately borne by shoppers themselves, in some cases through higher prices in shop shelves." He continued, "With a swathe of new mandated rules in the pipeline or under consideration, and which may lead to more flashpoints in store, the SRC wants tackling crime against retailers to be made a greater priority by the authorities, including in the Scottish Government's strategic police priorities to ensure our shops are made safer."
John Mason.
Lists the problems we face, and I think we're all in agreement with that. I don't know if she was at the cross-party group on Tuesday when a lot of this was discussed, but does she have any practical solutions other than more money, higher taxes, or how does she think in practice we deal with this?
Sharon Dowie.
I'm actually covering that in my speech, and there's more to come, but we need to get more police on our streets, and we need to do more to retain the police officers that we already have. So there is suggestions within the speech if the member wants to listen. So the Scottish Retail Consortium also previously pointed out that thieves are becoming more brazen and aggressive, and this isn't just affecting convenience stores, but chemists, garden centres, fashion stores and retailers more widely. The impact is being felt across all retail destinations. This is all happening despite stores taking real action to try and prevent it. They have spent fortunes on CCTV, body-worn cameras and other attempts to protect workers. In some stores, they supply their security guards with stab-proof vests. But it's not making much of a difference because the problem is so widespread. And the consequences for criminals are almost non-existent. So offenders not only get away with it, they're almost encouraged to keep doing it because there are no repercussions. This government must face the reality that allowing police officer numbers to fall to the lowest level in more than a decade has real-world consequences. And so too does sending a message to criminals that they can get away with crimes or face very little punishment, or, as I heard this morning, no punishment. So what needs to happen to change this and give retail workers the protection they deserve? Firstly, Police Scotland needs more resources, and the aim should be to increase frontline officer numbers and retain those officers we already have. Without more officers responding quickly to these crimes, thieves will never be caught, and shops will be and are discouraged from even reporting abusive or violent behaviour. And as I heard this morning, 70% of the crimes are caused by 10% of the offenders. So we need to do more investigation into the crimes, and we need to make sure that there are consequences for those that are actually committing the crimes. And also at this point, I want to stress that we need to keep our officers safe by issuing body-worn cameras for them too. We've already heard that issuing these would be a game changer, and anything we can do to improve their safety should be implemented as soon as possible. And it could also help with retention of the officers that we already have. Secondly, there must be better means of reporting incidents by retailers so that problem areas can be quickly identified, targeted and prevented. As it stands, retailers do not believe this is happening. And thirdly, more consideration needs to be given to the pressures that government is imposing on workers and businesses. Rules on the selling of products is often a flashpoint for abuse or violence, but the government is looking to expand the use of these rules in the future. For instance, SRC have cited challenges, including September's rise in alcohol minimum unit pricing, upcoming restrictions in the sale of vapes and tobacco, and proposed new rules on the location in-store of alcohol products and also a disposable cup levy. If these proposals are to go ahead, they should be communicated clearly to the public at large. The rules must be explained, because I heard this morning that retailers are already concerned about the imminent increase in MUP and the lack of public awareness through Scottish Government communication. There must be clear signals saying that abusive or violent customer behaviour is unacceptable and will face punishment. So far, the Scottish Government has not acted decisively on retail crime. Lack of police officers, police response times, making it easier to log incidents, ongoing issues with bus passes are some of the issues that were raised this morning. It has let down workers and businesses through inaction. I hope this debate will shed more light on the challenges facing frontline staff, and it will kickstart not only a conversation but action on how we can solve these issues so nobody faces threats in their workplace every single day. Thank you.
Thank you. Just to advise the Chamber, with the 2 o'clock restart of afternoon business, we're a little tight for time, so I'd be grateful if members could stick roughly to the speaking time allocations. We move to the open debate. I call first Ben McPherson, to be followed by Pam Gosal, around 4 minutes. Mr McPherson.
Thank you very much, and I commend Sharon Dowie as well for bringing this important debate to the Chamber. Similarly to Bob Dorris, who brought a related debate to the Chamber on the use of off-road vehicles just last week. And these are issues that are affecting constituencies across Scotland, and particularly in urban areas. And they should not be underestimated. The importance of retail to the economy has been well stated by the member already. And the issues that she highlights with retail crime and antisocial behaviour are absolutely something that is a concern in my constituency, having met with a number of the leading supermarkets who've briefed me on the problems that they've been facing and the issues that their staff have been confronting for some time, and that these issues have been on the rise. But also small businesses as well. Not too far from the Parliament, I visited some businesses in my constituency who were dealing with a number of issues across the summer, and been helping them to secure a more regular police presence in that area to try and address the matter. And, you know, we celebrated small businesses in Parliament just a few days ago when Audrey Nicholl had a debate on the 50th anniversary of the Federation of Small Businesses. And if our big supermarkets and big retailers are struggling with this issue, imagine what it's like if you're just one or two people trying to deal with it. So I actually think this issue, and also the issue of off-road vehicles, this growing concern being perpetrated by a very small group of people, but having a significant economic impact and social impact, and becoming a growing trend, really is something that we have to prioritise. And as well as today's debate, I would encourage the government to have a debate in government time as a follow-up on these matters, because while this is an operational issue in many ways for Police Scotland, and there is a question of resource, and the allocation of resource, does it need to be prioritised more in urbanly dense areas like the constituency I represent and the member represents, to try and get on top of this issue and to suppress it as a trend? But it's also about other interventions in smart justice, whether it's the utilisation of youth work in terms of helping the young people who, again, a minority of young people who are engaging in this behaviour, and sometimes being utilised, shall we say, by organised crime in this area because of the age of the young people involved and the difference in terms of how they're treated within the criminal justice system. And I note that the Scottish Grocers Federation have indicated some of the figures that 49% of shop theft, according to their figures, is committed by repeat offenders with drug and alcohol addiction, and that shows also that this is an overlapping issue in terms of how we support those out of addiction. Continued argument for safe consumption rooms. I increasingly believe that we need a safe consumption room or perhaps more than one in Edinburgh, for example. So we need to work across government on the difficulty of this issue and the multifaceted nature of how we achieve solutions, because and that applies also to removing bus passes if required, and we debated that in Parliament some time ago now. I do think, you know, we need to look seriously at whether bus passes should be removed for some time if people are continuing to engage in criminal behaviour and antisocial behaviour. So just finally, Presiding Officer, I would say that, you know, this is a growing concern. If we don't get on top of it, not only is it going to continue to cause real problems for shop workers and in our communities, but it's also undermining the concept of the rule of law, and that's a real problem for all of us.
Thank you very much. I call Pam Gosell to be followed by Daniel Johnson in around 4 minutes. Ms Gosell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Let me begin by my speech by thanking my friend and colleague Sharon Dow for bringing this important issue to the Scottish Parliament. I would also like to thank all the organisations which have supplied briefings for today's members' business, and also welcome David Lousdale from the Scottish Retail Consortium and businesses to the Chamber today. Retail crime and antisocial behaviour represents a significant issue in Scotland. Figures from Police Scotland have shown that between August 2021 and January 2024, 10,295 incidents of shoplifting were reported to Police Scotland, while 92.8% of respondents to a survey from the Scottish Grocers Federation reported that violence against staff occurs on a weekly basis. The same survey found that more than a third of responding businesses have experienced incidents of violence with perpetrators using weapons. This morning, I attended a roundtable on retail crime, hosted by my colleague Sharon Dowie and chaired by David Lousdale from the Scottish Retail Consortium. We heard that businesses are not just combating shoplifting, but also violent crimes, many times with the use of dangerous weapons such as knives. Here are some of the issues highlighted today. One representative made reference to a psychological harm caused to retailers, with one retail worker even suffering a miscarriage. Several representatives expressed concerns over the young age of perpetrators engaging in violent behaviours, many of which were under the age of 16 with no consequences. Another representative said that bookshops are faced with violence as perpetrators are opposed to certain books being sold there. While another representative brought up the fact that there is only one police officer responsible for retail crime across Scotland. Shoplifting and antisocial behaviour remains an issue in my region of the west of Scotland. I was recently contacted by two business improvement districts which represent a substantial number of businesses across my region. Kirkintilloch and Milngavie Bid have informed me that they have experienced increasing shoplifting and shoplifters becoming more brazen and aggressive while the police response is ineffective. One major supermarket in Milngavie has had to close one of its main entrances due to shoplifters walking out with baskets full of shopping through the main street, while another retailer has said that they experience shoplifting daily. The Bids also expressed concerns that this activity will become worse as we approach Christmas period. At the same time, the rollout of upgraded CCTV across East Dumbartonshire has been talked about for over 2 years and still not delivered by East Dumbartonshire Council. Thieves seem to know where all the cameras are and plenty of blind spots still exist, despite offers from the Milngavie Bid to the Council to fund additional cameras to integrate with the main CCTV system currently in place. Shopkeepers should not have to go through the stress of having constantly monitoring their merchandise. This is an issue I recently raised with the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs in a letter, and I asked if she could outline what action her government is taking to prevent retail crime, whether it has formulated a strategy with Police Scotland to clamp down on shoplifters. The SNP's soft touch approach to justice and lack of suitable resources are a root causes of shoplifting and antisocial behaviour in retail. Police numbers have fallen into their lowest in 17 years, while I also was disappointed to hear that certain crimes will no longer be investigated due to this government's proportionate response to crime approaches. Similarly, high raises on businesses mean that businesses, especially SMEs, find installing new security equipment challenging. That is why, as mentioned during Tuesday's members' debate, I was disappointed that the SNP government did not pass 75% business rates relief for businesses from the previous UK Conservative government. In closing, Presiding Officer, I would therefore hope that in her concluding, the Minister would outline detailed strategy to tackle retail crime, which includes an increase in policing and support for businesses which help enhance their security. Sorry, I couldn't take an intervention due to time.
Thank you. I now call Daniel Johnson to be followed by Gordon MacDonald around 4 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I too thank Sharon Dowie for securing time to debate something which I hope other members know is something that is very close to my heart. And I think she is absolutely right to highlight the human impact that this has. But let me be clear. I had hoped that this is a debate we wouldn't have to have. I hoped that through the course of the COVID pandemic, something had changed. We all stood here and a number of times discussed that we needed to understand that retail workers were frontline workers, that they were undervalued, and this was a point to reevaluate their importance. Ultimately, we are dependent on retail and retail workers in order to secure the necessities and essentials for life. But I think we have regressed. Now, obviously, I brought forward my Member's Bill in the last Parliament, which is now an Act of Parliament, the Retail Protection Retail Workers Bill, and that has at least made some impact. We at least know some of the numbers. According to the latest figures, there have been over 10,000 reports under that. There's been a 61% detection rate. 1,200 people have been convicted under that legislation. There's over 1,000 cases proceeding through the courts. But clearly, it is not enough. And I think we are seeing an escalation. And you know, I think let's also be clear about that human impact, because anyone that has had to challenge a shoplifter, anyone that has had to ask someone to leave, make that physical confrontation, knows what it's like. They know what it's like to have your heart pound, your nerves jangle. And even if it's successful, even if you get the person out of your store without any harm to yourself, you are left stunned and reeling for the rest of that day. And you have to go back. You have to return to that place of stress and trauma. So I can only imagine what it must be like if you are the victim of violence, what that must be like, to return to the place where you were assaulted. And let's be clear, this is a problem that is getting worse. And can I remind the Chamber of my register of interest? I'm a member of the Shop Workers Union, Usdaw, and the owner of a business that has retail interests. But according to Usdaw's most recent survey, 18% of shop workers surveyed experienced violence in the last year. 18%, one in five. What makes that worse is it's a dramatic increase. Only 8% in the year before. And in 2019, that was only 5%. That is an extraordinary rise, and one that we should all find unacceptable. Now, can I just, I think, agree absolutely with what Ben McPherson has just said? These are serious issues. I think one that I think all of us recognise they're not easy answers to, but I think we do need a debate on government time. I agree with his point about bus passes. That doesn't need to be all or nothing. I've spoken with Lothian buses and others. I think there are technical possibilities that there could be time-limited restrictions and so on and so forth. I would ask the government to look at that. But it is also absolutely right to highlight the point around organised crime. Because when I talk to retailers against crime, retailers themselves, what is clear is that there's a growing pattern of organised crime using vulnerable people to steal to order. And those proceeds cycling around the black economy, financing drug dealers, human traffickers, another far more serious. So this is not a trivial crime. It's not a victimless crime. And it is one that certainly has consequences into far more serious areas. But I think we should also look at the pattern of policing. Well, I think, first of all, we need police to be far more engaged with retailers, looking at solutions and more effective reporting. But above all else, I think having more police officers, and I'll just close on this point, is one thing. But actually, the balance of policing has gone away from response officers because of the creation of Police Scotland. Specialised units, I think, have taken police officers, and we need to question whether that balance is correct. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. I now call Gordon MacDonald to be followed by Russell Finlay, around 4 minutes. Mr MacDonald.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Sharon Dowie for bringing forward this important debate on retail crime. I also bring to the attention of the Chamber that I am the convener of the cross-party group on independent convenience stores, and that on Tuesday of this week we had presentations from organisations and retailers on this very subject. I will take this opportunity to thank those MPs, John Mason, Faisal Chowdhury and Myrtle Fraser, who attended and discussed this subject with over 20 representatives of the sector. Presiding Officer, there is no doubt that shoplifting is on the rise across the UK, with British Retail Consortium highlighting that there were 5.6 million incidents of shop theft recorded in 2023 compared to 1.1 million in 2022. In Scotland, over the last 10 years since 2014, there has been a 41% rise in shoplifting, costing shop store owners anything between £5,000 and £12,000 each year. Scottish Grocers Federation's Scottish Crime Report for 23-24 suggests that cases of shoplifting in the last year have doubled. The report also highlights that many retailers are reluctant to report cases of shoplifting to the police due to slow response times, which undermines the effectiveness of reporting the crime and solving it. A constituent of mine who attended the meeting on Tuesday night highlighted that on top of the regular cases of shoplifting, they had for the first time in over 20 years been robbed of a large quantity of high-value goods while the store was open. They then had to wait over a week for the police to attend. Another retailer highlighted how two incidents back in 2016 had a traumatic impact on their health. This was because they had been broken into overnight twice in a 21-day period where organised crime gangs stole high-value items. They then had to bear the cost of carrying out repairs and the expense of upgrading security, only to find that their insurance companies wouldn't pay out. The result was that the cost was borne by a family business which provides a service to the community and employs 16 people. Shoplifting or theft is not a victimless crime. Another aspect of retail crime is the threat of violence. Again, across the UK, the Association of Convenience Stores reported that in the last year there were 76,000 incidents of violence and 1.2 million cases of verbal abuse. One of the ways we've tried to address this issue in Scotland was thanks to the Scottish Grocers Federation, who, working across the political spectrum, put in place the Protection of Workers Act, which came into force in August 2021. We now have a record of the number of cases of abuse, threats and violence towards shop workers that are recorded in Scotland. But that's not enough. While I welcome that, in Scotland there are 20% more police officers than in England and that there are 22% more police officers in Wales, we need to do more. The cross-party group on Tuesday highlighted a number of issues that could be done to help retailers combat the issue of shoplifting. One, establish a self-reporting scheme in order that low-level crime is measured, highlighting hotspots and helping retailers to support each other and be on alert when incidents happen in their neighbourhood. Two, investigate the possibility of introducing small grants to independent convenience stores to partially cover the cost of better security, which will help deter crime. And three, revise the guidance around the use of CCTV covering the front of premises in order that cameras can be more effective in gathering evidence but can also be used as a deterrent to would-be shoplifters. Presiding officer, across our towns, villages and neighbourhoods, shopping areas, local people are dependent on the independent convenience store sector to provide the everyday necessities of living in that area. We need to address the issue of shoplifting in our communities before it becomes an epidemic and threatens the viability of many of these stores.
Thank you very much indeed. I now call Russell Finlay to be followed by Richard Leonard, around 4 minutes. Mr Finlay.
Thanks, President Officer. And I begin by congratulating my colleague Sharon Dowie for securing today's important debate. Now, this morning we sat down with senior representatives of Scottish retailers, companies who are at the heart of our communities, companies that we all rely on and that drive our economy and employ so many people. The financial cost of retail crime is impossible to properly calculate, but of much greater concern is the impact on shop workers. Violence is rife and some staff have already been killed. Many of these tragic cases have not been reported in the media. Just last week, I raised the case of a Glasgow shopkeeper who was stabbed. The police quickly arrested the teenage assailant, who was then released back onto the streets. Within half an hour, he had murdered an innocent man. Now, I'm not going to talk about statistics. As one of today's attendees said, the figures have become almost irrelevant, due partly to underreporting. Suffice to say that retail crime is out of control in Scotland. And it's not me saying that, it's the retailers and the police. This government has systematically weakened the justice system to the extent that shoplifting has been decriminalised by stealth. And what do I mean by that? Well, if retailers call the police and they don't attend, there is no consequence. If a thief is caught but given a recorded police warning instead of being charged, there is no consequence. And if they are charged, the chance of a conviction have become close to non-existent. So again, no consequences. By deliberately and systematically removing consequences, there is no deterrent. And this leads to the inevitable consequence of criminals who believe they can act with impunity. Presiding Officer, a significant amount of retail crime is committed by organised criminal gangs. Last week, I heard about a group of teenagers based in the Glasgow area. They are currently travelling around Scotland using free bus passes to do so, to commit large-scale thefts. It's targeted and it's organised. The gang members are brazen. They make no attempts to hide their faces and they sweep high-value items from the shelves, alcoholic spirits being the primary target. It's suspected that this group are under the direction of adult organised criminals. These gangs are increasingly violent because they know there are no consequences. I've seen numerous sickening CCTV videos of these people spitting on staff, punching them, threatening them, doing what they want with no consequence. And it's inevitable that more people will end up dead. The police tell the retailers that their hands are tied, and I speak with police officers who often feel powerless and frustrated. It seems the Scottish Government is content to subcontract retail security onto the shoulders of retailers. Retailers already invest huge sums of money into protecting their staff and their stock. And it says a lot about the priorities of this government that Police Scotland officers still don't have body-worn cameras, while these are standard kit in almost every single shop you go into. Presiding officer, at today's meeting, I told the retailers that my party is on their side. We're on the side of their staff. We believe that crime should have consequences, and they can be assured that I and my colleagues will continue to challenge this government's relentless weakening of our justice system. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Richard Leonard to be followed by Alexander Stewart. Around 4 minutes, Mr. Leonard.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I begin by reminding members of my register of voluntary interests? Can I also thank Sharon Dowie for tabling this motion for today's debate? She is one of the members of this Parliament who brings a real-world experience to bear on issues and so deserves to be listened to. There is no question but that violence, theft and the abuse of shop workers is on the rise. The Scottish Retail Consortium tell us. The Union of Shop, Distributive and Allied Workers tells us. The frontline workers I speak to tell me. And today's motion echoes the calls we have heard from the industry for the Scottish Government to provide the police and the courts with the necessary direction and resources to prosecute offenders. Well, the fact is that the police are not routinely arresting offenders at all. According to shop workers I've spoken to, Police Scotland will only charge people for shoplifting, for example, if they have a previous record or they are known to them, which begs the question, how do you get a previous record if you're never cautioned, never charged, never prosecuted, and never sentenced? But conversely, the other side of this approach is that for some people there is a revolving door in and out of prison for minor offences, often including shoplifting and the non-payment of fines. I spoke just recently to one bright, engaged and engaging young person who told me that, in his own words, he was an addict and that he had spent most of the last few years in and out of prison for minor offences related to his addiction, including shoplifting. In my view, he clearly needed a helping hand, not an iron fist. So I do think we need to have balance in this debate. Usdaw, in its 2023 annual Freedom from Fear survey, describes, I quote, a shoplifting epidemic driven by the cost of living crisis and organised crime. Amongst their retail membership, they report 7 out of 10 respondents reported verbal abuse. 46% received threats of violence. And as Daniel Johnson said, 18% were physically assaulted. We know that the biggest single cause of retail crime occurred when somebody was being confronted for shoplifting, and shoplifting has risen over 40% in the last decade. The annual Crime in Scotland report also records that almost a quarter of retail crimes occurred in one of Scotland's top 15% most deprived areas, and that 41% of perpetrators resided in Scotland's most deprived areas. So there is clearly a link to poverty, inequality, to hopelessness and to powerlessness. Finally, this Parliament passes legislation on alcohol minimum unit pricing, on vapes and tobacco, on the shelving and display of alcohol, on fireworks. But the enforcement of those laws that we pass invariably falls to those low-paid shop workers out on the front line, which is why they need protection, which is why we passed a law in this Parliament to do just that. But like any other piece of protective legislation, it needs to be enforced. And that places a requirement on retailers to take their duty of care to their staff seriously. That demands the police treat these incidents not as occupational hazards, but as crimes. That means we as a society need to get to the root causes which lie behind this rise in retail crime. And it underlines the important role of trade unions in enforcing the rights that working people have got, which also means we need to challenge those employers, amongst them some of the biggest supermarket chains, which continue to resist trade union membership and organisation. So this is about dignity at work, but it's also about democracy at work. This is about workers' rights, but it is also about human rights.
Thank you very much. We now come to the final speaker in the open debate, Alexander Stewart. Around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am pleased to be able to speak in this debate, and I commend and congratulate my colleague, Sharon Dowie, for bringing this very important issue to the Chamber today. Retailers play an increasingly important role in communities across the country and are the lifeblood of many sectors of our economy. We can all agree it is unacceptable for those working in retail settings to find themselves subject to any kind of abuse. Unfortunately, the reality, and we've heard that from many speakers today, is that abuse is continually happening the length and breadth of the country. Today's motion rightly highlights the alarming trends that we're seeing across the country. Earlier this year, the crime report from Scotland's Grocer Federation found that 100% of retailers reported an increase in shoplifting in the last year. 99% said it happened on a daily occurrence within their stores. The report also found that the cost of this crime was up to £12,000 per store, totalling to £62.9 million across Scotland in the year. Perhaps the most shocking was that 92% of stores reported that violence against staff occurred at least once a week. Clearly, this is a serious problem, and serious action and solutions are required, Presiding Officer. In recent years, the implementation of the Protection of Workers Act 2021 has been a welcome step, but only a step. Under the Act, over 10,000 incidents have already been reported to the police since August 21, which shows the scale of the problem that we are facing. However, more needs to be done to ensure that the perpetrators are prosecuted. That's what needs to happen. There needs to be consequences. We've heard that already. Despite Police Scotland identifying the person responsible in 60% of cases, only 11% of these report in a conviction. Only 11%. On top of this, the SDFA have highlighted that the lack of response and the lack of confidence that retailers have in the police is affecting the situation. They have found that 90% of retailers believe that the response rate to shoplifting indicates are unsatisfactory or insufficiently delayed. Now, this shouldn't be being delayed. There should be being consequences to the actions. The low conviction rates show that we are not attacking this in the right way. 75% of retailers say they are unlikely to report incidents because of that. So it's having a massive effect on the sector and on the individuals who work in that sector. That means that the true extent is not being actually seen. The raw data is not being covered and convicted. While legislation is there to protect, and it's a step forward, much, much more needs to be done. For example, today's motion speaks about the Scottish Retail Consortium's call for greater focus on retail crime for both Police Scotland and the Scottish Government to take this much more seriously. We cannot tolerate the situation where police are unable to investigate a supposed minor incidents of shoplifting simply due to the lack of resources by the government. Instead, we should be aiming to tackle a system that doesn't hesitate in reporting and supporting individuals from shoplifting It's mightily important. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, for the individuals working in retail up and down the country and who suffer this reality each and every day and week, a no-tolerance approach to retail crime and abuse is the least that they deserve, and we should support them in that. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Stewart. I now call on Siobhan Brown to respond to the debate. Minister, around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Firstly, can I thank Sharon Dowie for raising this really important issue. I'm aware that earlier this week, the cross-party group on independent convenience stores met to discuss many of these issues too. And as the member notes, shoplifting, violence and abuse against retail workers is part of a worrying trend across the whole of the UK. It's not unique to Scotland, but it is rightly causing concern amongst our retailers. The latest police recorded crime statistics for the year ending this June suggest that shoplifting itself is up by more than a third on the previous year. That is not acceptable, and neither is the violence and the threatening behaviour which often accompanies such incidents. And I thank all the members for their contributions today. I know this is a really emotive issue, and I think every single one of us sitting in the chamber, regardless of our political colour, wants to tackle this issue. Russell Finlay.
Russell Finlay.
Thank you. I just wonder if the Minister accepts that the shocking rise that she accepts is happening is in any way due to the fact there are no consequences for those committing these crimes.
Minister, and if you could just adjust the microphone slightly.
Yes, thank you. And I will come on to some of the issues that have been raised further on in my speech, Mr. Finlay. I've heard concerns about these issues firsthand when I attended the Retail Industry Leadership Group on March the 14th and the Scottish Consortium on Retail Consortium on March the 19th. And at these meetings, I heard about the work retailers are doing to cope with these issues, including the extra security measures and support for staff, as well as their views on what is driving the upward trend. And I appreciate Mrs. Dowie's previous career and experiencing violence in the retail sector in a past life. I have also personally experienced it, so I have had experience there as well. While it can't be entirely attributed to the cost of living, Police Scotland have been clear with me that it is undoubtedly a major driver in the increase. These incidents are deeply concerning, and that is why I would urge all retailers to keep reporting crimes. I appreciate that some won't, but I will be coming onto an initiative that's been introduced by Police Scotland later in my speech that could encourage this. Each crime report aids our collective understanding of who is doing this and why, and police officers may also have the intelligence so they can catch the perpetrators. Policing in Scotland continues to be a priority for the Scottish Government. Our budget for 24-25 includes record police total funding of £1.55 billion, which was an increase of £92.7 million on the previous year, despite exceptionally difficult financial circumstances due to the UK Government austerity. Mr Johnson.
Daniel Johnson.
I wonder if the Minister might respond to the point that I made in my speech about the fact it's not about the numbers or necessarily the funding, but actually the model of policing that we've adopted, where it seems to, I think, that we prioritise the central specialist units over response units, meaning that we have less response officers than we did prior to police reorganisation, and that contributes to the issue.
Minister, I can give you the time back for the intervention.
I do, but I also believe that, and I think we discussed this in another debate last week, Mr Johnson, that there is an issue with collaborative working in local authorities as well, with police, for example. I had a meeting last week with my local police, and they were able to tell me that they could identify all the shoplifters within Ayrtown Centre, and they knew how to get in touch with them. So I think there is a collaborative approach between local authorities, because it's not just up to the police. There has to be a collaborative working between the council, antisocial behaviour, and with police. Going back to the funding for Police Scotland, this funding will allow the Chief Constable to deliver on her commitment to strengthen the force through her plans for a revised model of policing, including enabling the service to restart recruitment and to increase officer numbers. Now, I note that a few of the members have called for more police, and I'm glad to report that Police Scotland has welcomed over 690 new officers since March and over 1,280 new recruits since the beginning of 2023. Further intakes are planned throughout this year, with Police Scotland set to take on more recruits this year than any time since 2013. And Police Scotland described the number of candidates and applicants looking to join up as really positive, so that I'd hope you would welcome that. I am encouraged by the approach Police Scotland is taking in tackling shoplifting and to address these recent trends. Central to this work is an innovative Scottish Partnership Against Acquisitive Crime strategy, also known as SPACE, which is led by Police Scotland and is working with retailers and other organisations, including Retailers Against Crime and Neighbourhood Watch Scotland. Their focus is on prevention, deterrence and, where appropriate, enforcement. In the motion, I note that the member raises a point about protection of retail workers in the south of Scotland region. However, I know that across the whole country, officers have engaged directly with retailers of various sizes on how to minimise opportunities for this type of crime, protect individuals and businesses, and deliver clear advice and guidance for prevention. I would ask that retailers take an advantage. Did someone ask for an intervention? I would ask that the retailers take advantage of Police Scotland's advice in this area. While the problem must also be tackled through enforcement, ensuring premises are not an easy target for shoplifters is also important. The Scottish Government underlines its support for the SPACE approach in our programme for government published earlier this month, but I'd like to draw members' attention to a specific pilot project that Police Scotland have initiated in Fife. And given the statistics that have been raised about retailers not willing to report crime, there is work being undertaken. So Police Scotland, together with partners and IT providers, Mr. Dowie?
Sharon Dowie.
Thank you. You actually mentioned in a previous question about the pilot that was taking place in Fife. It's not in my region. I wasn't able to find out much information about it, but the feedback that I have got from one group that are involved in it is that they're reporting crimes. It's a new way to report them, but there's been no action taken by police. And that seems to be the ongoing issue, is that the retailers aren't reporting any incidents to the police because the police don't have the capacity to go and respond.
Minister.
Thank you. I will have to look into that. I'll give you further information, but I have been told that reports have been submitted to the Procurator Fiscal because of this pilot. But going back to the pilot, the Police Scotland, together with partners and IT providers, have helped to develop a platform allowing staff within stores to send in direct details of crime to Police Scotland so that offences can be investigated. This does happen in other parts of the UK and is also happening in New Zealand. There have been engagement with businesses across the local authority area encouraging participation in the pilot. So following a soft launch earlier this year, the Go Live in September 2024 saw more retailers join the platform, which has already seen the positive identification of offenders and a number of reports submitted to the Procurator Fiscal. The ability for stores to compile their own crime report and submit these directly to police not only empowers these businesses to take action against the criminals, but it frees up police time to investigate incidents. Lead officers hope to see further arrests being made as part of this pilot, and I would join them in encouraging as many retailers as possible in Fife to get involved, and I would really hope that this would be rolled out throughout the whole of Scotland. This debate has raised an important point about the use of criminal law in attacks against retail workers. Retail workers are already protected by a wide range of criminal laws, including, of course, the Protection of Workers legislation, which came into force in August 2021 and which was based on a members' bill by Daniel Johnson. Today's motion rightly highlights the impact that legislation has had in improving visibility and legal protection for retail workers. While it's always shocking to hear that retail workers are being threatened and abused, they should feel confident in reporting such offences, and they are being taken seriously by the police. I am very conscious of time, but one issue that I did want to raise, if I could, was the issue of bus passes. I'm sorry, I'm not going to take any more interventions. We're running too short of time. So there is work ongoing with stakeholders, including the bus industry, to develop specific actions to tackle antisocial behaviour on the bus network, and work to develop a process for temporary suspension or withdrawal of concessionary travel entitlement through the National concessionary travel schemes is being progressed for consideration in the medium term, including assessment of the most appropriate route to enable this within the statutory scheme. So there is work undergoing regarding the police. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I welcome the opportunity to have this debate about these important issues and again thank the member for bringing this motion forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I suspend this meeting of Parliament until 2 o'clock.